Before I get started today, I want to talk about a problem that some of us will have if we're at our wood shops in our basements. My house, as you can tell by the foundation, is the granite foundation with big, huge blocks. It was built in the 1860s by the Colony family that made the mills here in my town. And as such, it's a damp basement. I don't know if standing water, you know, feels dry, but the air is just damp. Even in the winter, it's damp. And what comes from that is rust. I got these tools from my father-in-law less than a year ago. I've been storing them in plastic bins with a desiccant in them. The desiccant stuff is kind of cool. It's put out by a company called Wiseorb. It's this silica gel beads. You can see that it's orange here because this is a brand new pack. And after it gets exposed to moisture, it turns a dark green, almost a black, and that way, you know, you recharge it. You recharge it by popping it in the oven, taking out the plastic covers for a couple hours, and it turns all orange again. If you're in a hurry, you can put it on a cookie sheet, and if you do that, you'll never get rid of silica gel out of your kitchen. So I'll never do that again. You cannot pour them back in. It just can't. But even with the silica gel in a regular plastic, you know, storage tub, stuff like this happened. See right there? It's not much. We got some on the sides also. It's even worse up here. This is fixable. It's not a problem. I'll get a really fine sandpaper and my marble block, and just like I'm sharpening a blade, I'll work the bottom of this. However, it's gonna happen again. Yeah, I can oil it, I can wax it, but I'm gonna miss spots. So the other thing I got was this tub. I got a couple of them off of Amazon, sorry. You can't find this stuff locally, I tried. The company's called ISIS, I think, I-S-I-S, not the terrorist group, no. But they make just look like regular plastic tubs. Except we can see here, it's got a foam gasket in it. So when the tools are in here, and the silica gel, and latch them all down. Oops, missed that. Whatever moisture's in there now will be absorbed by the gel, and so that it won't rust any further. At least that's the hope. So I got all the tools put away today, except for the ones I'll be using, and I'll store them there when I'm not using them. And I got some de-rusting to do on a couple of these really nice tools. I mean, this is a work of art. Look at this. And we have some rust forming. Ah, cried when I saw that on this. These are from Lee Nielsen in Maine. Makes heirloom quality tools. Even got rust there on the brass. No, that's oil. That's varnish, sorry. But yeah, so I gotta take care of my tools better. I thought I had been doing a good job, but the silica gel stuff in a non-sealed tub is not sufficient. But let's go use a plane now. I wanted to mention one more thing. I forgot to say it in that last segment. This stuff isn't cheap, okay? One of these, I think it's 750 grams, is 17 bucks. However, it's a deal also, because the other product they have is 100 grams for $10. It's like, yeah, it's a much better deal, and this means you'll have to service it 1/7 as much, I guess. There are other cheaper vendors on Amazon that sell this stuff. It's probably the same beads, but you read the reviews and the canisters are crap. They break open, stuff spills out, and one of them even sells them such that they come to you probably green, not orange, and sometimes baking in the oven works, sometimes baking in the oven doesn't work. So you gotta get the good stuff. The bins aren't cheap also. They're about 20 bucks each, but your tools aren't cheap, so you gotta take care of your tools, and you gotta spend money to not wreck money, not to spend money to not lose money. So I'm about to start cutting, and, well, planing, not cutting, and I remembered how the ends looked funny last time. I just wanted to go over everything, and so I restrung the line, and I'm seeing something that's a little weird. The middle is right here. Let's tighten that up. And what you can see here is that, hopefully you can see it, the line is about a 16th off from my pencil line. So for whatever reason, when I drew the pencil line, I wasn't very accurate. And so what this means is the center of the paddle is more this way as opposed to being, you know, it's more towards me as opposed to being this way. I have it just to here to be shaving, it looks like just a 16th off. And so now I should be shaving none off here. Well, none off here, I guess. This is the center of the loom. These are the where the shoulders are. And so if I'm a 16th off here, you know, halfway down, I'll be half of a 16th off. And frankly, I don't believe that that's going to matter because I don't think I have that kind of precision available to me. So I'm just going to wing it. So now we start the part I really like, the hand planing. I mean, I like spoke shaving maybe better, but I like both of them a whole lot. And what I have here is I have a number 7 plane. When you're planing large sections of wood, you want to use the biggest plane you got. And this is the biggest one I have. A number 7, I took notes, is called it's called a jointer plane. A number 6, which is smaller, is called a 4 plane. A number 5, which is smaller still, is called a jack plane. You've seen me use the block plane and the smoothing plane, even smaller, before. Now we get the big guns out. This is not a Stanley, this is made by Record, which I think is a British company. I hope I'm right. If I'm wrong, I'll edit the video. We have here's the center line. I think you'll probably see it in the video. Here's where the shoulder starts. Recall that this is about an inch and a half wide, but I'm making an inch and a quarter paddle. So from here at the shoulder line, from here down is all I'm planing. Okay, none of this is the right height over here. That's not true on the other side, and we'll get to that when I get to that. You want to start down here, it's got to take the most off down here. Down here I'm taking probably three-eighths, maybe a little more than that, off down here. And here, of course, I'm taking nothing. Let's give it a shot. Well, that's exciting. It dug in, because again, this is flat sawn, not quarter sawn, and so the grain isn't very good here, and it dragged my thing a little bit, which is funny. I should be planing this way to get that, and my workshop is small enough that that's gonna be difficult, but I'll figure something out. I've shifted the piece this way a little bit, which I'm not gonna be able to do when I do the other side. So I'm not, hopefully the grain will be working better. I've got a Craftsman workbench over there, and it's actually under the top of it. And so the next piece, since it has to be higher, won't be able to do that. Also off camera, moved my standing drill press so I can actually stand it. Let's see if I can get this to work now. I had to move the camera around because I wasn't gonna be sticking my butt in the camera the whole time. Let's see if I can get this working now. I'm not gonna like this, but nope, I didn't think so. Some off, not as much as I want, but slower is better. You can see I couldn't come in this side, which I needed to do, and the jam was happening here. So maybe I'm gonna get lucky and be able to go this way. I'll keep on trying and see what happens. Blade is set pretty shallow, which is fine for me now. Actually, maybe I'll take it in a little bit. Yeah, that's what we're talking about. See, it's still getting tear out there. Oh, I hate this.
More tear out. This would not be happening if I had vertical grain wood, and that's why you should try and get vertical grain wood. I don't have vertical grain wood, so it's the best I can do right now. We'll make it work. We'll do it the best we got. Just watching my line. Really tempting. I think I did this in the first series. Just to be holding the plane at an angle like this or an angle like that. I've got a really thin strip doing that, but I think that's a bit imprecise. And holding the plane flat against the board is a better way to do it. It's interesting, of course, the board is flat and I'm trying to cut an angle, you know, like that. So I'm actually trying to, you know, lift the plane a little bit. As I get further along back, it's going to be angled but flat. I hate that. This wood here is almost perfectly smooth. You know, you can put like a table out of this or fine furniture and all. Crap fine furniture and it'd be so good. This down here, where it chattered, oh, it's awful. I'm getting such tear out. This is awful. I'm gonna try going this way. That's really, oh man. That's worse. Obviously, I don't know what I'm doing. This is great fun. I'm going to turn it off now because I'm obviously not going to be putting an hour's worth of footage of me planing up online, so I'll have to delete it anyhow. So this, I'll just figure some stuff out and come back to you. So I want to show you the crown that's forming and why I need to be concerned about it. I'm not near my line yet, but I'm getting there. Take our square, we're gonna hold it here. And it's nice and nice and nice, but already here, there's probably a 16th on. I'll hopefully be able to zoom in on the camera and you can see that. They get further down, across over here. I mean, there's light here. You know, I'm an inch in, I got significant light under it. Get down to the bottom, and you can see here that from here to here, I'm falling off, so I am not planing straight. So my maybe going like this gets the job done, but what's also happening is I'm going downhill here and cutting off far more than I intend to. So I just gotta be super careful. Maybe I stand on this side some and go like that. We'll see. So I've gotta be super careful here. I came in on this side and I was taking lots of wood off. You can see there's grooves forming here in the top of the wood, which I'll have to plane away. It's annoying that I did that. But what's worse is look at my pencil line. I'm getting awfully close to it, okay? And let's take the camera on the other side. You'll see what it looks like there. Over here on this side, we can see we have a lot of wood. You know, here there's probably twice as much wood I need to cut as I have here. So I'm really doing something wrong. I better fix this. I'm new enough at this that I hate blaming equipment because I'm old enough to know that I should be blaming myself, that the equipment is fine, and my technique is what needs work. And I'm certain I still need more technique. But what I did was I got out my number three, and it was working a whole lot better. And so I got to thinking, why is the number three working better than the number seven? And I didn't know if it was cutting too deep or not deep enough. I want it to be shallow to not gouge, but deep to take off a lot of wood. And so by looking at the blade, I wondered if it
I was trying to see to make it shallower, and that's, you know, that's this knurled knob on the back you got to adjust. And when I took my straight edge onto the blade and made it really shallow, you could see it, you know, rocking because this is obviously sticking up. But on one side, it wasn't rocking at all. It was completely flat. So that meant that the blade, I'll exaggerate, the blade was like that. And that's this lever here. You adjust side to side. And of course, it was cockeyed a little bit. Now it's perfectly straight and things are going a lot better. I won't say it's great, but it's going a lot better. Let me plane some more. Slowly working my way back here. You know, my pencil lines from here down are gone. My center line I drew, and here's where I have to stop. So I'm getting close to stopping. These things are going to be in the way, so I'm going to be hitting them. So I'm going to need to reset the piece. Need to reset the camera also. Amazing how this is walking. Hate that. One thing that isn't helping is my planing surface here isn't stable. I'm not too sure much I can do about it. I can probably put more rocks in here, make it heavier. But I shouldn't be exerting that much force. The catching is causing the chattering, and I shouldn't be catching. I just need to have some more talent. It's getting nicely done, though. I mean, it's been frustrating, but this is probably been a quarter inch, maybe less, of the line and virtually parallel to it. So I'm doing something right. Smash. It's just my clipboard falling. But I'm so close also, which is great. The funny thing is, the part that needs to cut most is now this section down here where I cut too much. But I can still feel the crown, so I've got to cut here, but I've got to cut flat and cut there. I can just feel it, you know. I could be using my square. But just those three or four strokes, I got rid of much of the crown. Your hands are remarkably sensitive for this. So now I'm taking essentially full strokes. Like you notice, but when I'm pulling back, I'm looking down to where the blade is and where the line is, because I don't want to go past. I'm just cutting from here down. Almost perfect one. I'm getting so close to the line, I need to be checking this side and that side constantly. And particularly here, it's very critical because there's so little. You know, from here back, I'm cutting zero off. So here, I'm cutting almost zero left. Thickest part is still down here on this side. Boy, this side's almost done. Here I am at the line, here I am not, so I gotta be careful. This side's essentially done. Maybe a 32nd, and I'm not gonna care about that too much. This side is still maybe a 16th in part, so I'm getting close. Here, I'm touching the line. From here to here, it's done. Here to here, little tiny bit. Little tiny bits. Of course it does that. But... So I can easily see light through, but it's gonna be harder for you in the camera. So let's see if this works. Yeah, that's not doing anything for you, is it? Oh, there, you can see over here. It's a little bit up over there. A little bit leaking there. So you can see it's not perfect, but it's pretty good, isn't it? You want this to be as flat as you can make it, because the next thing I'll be doing is I'll be drawing lines here where the paddle comes in and out. I want that to be correct. This is almost certainly as correct as my skill level can get it. So I think I'm gonna call this side done. So I wanted to make it clear what we did out there. You can see here the center line. This is where the thread went in, and here's the half inch blade width. And all this wood out here is gone. You can see here how it tapers out all the way out to the loom. And let's go get handheld shaky and see what happens. But nah. I'm not gonna be able to handheld that without you guys vomiting on me. I'll take some stills and we can see what's going on.